You know, I've been doing a lot of different videos lately, but what happened to the community countdowns? It's time I bring back my favorite series. Welcome to the Airsoft Tops Series, where we rank some of the greatest airsoft replicas and loadouts from all around the world. This is the show that brings in hundreds of entries and where thousands of enthusiasts look for ideas for their next loadouts. And for this episode, I've got loadouts spanning every style of airsoft. I don't want to do a MilSim only or a Speaky Bee focus countdown yet. I thought it would be more refreshing to show off a mix of all ideas. Just be sure to let me know if you're happy to see these videos coming back to the channel by hitting that like button. Maybe after 2,000 likes, I'll get started on the next countdown. But of course, I would like to thank SS Airsoft for supporting this series yet again. And I would like to shout out G&G Armament, who recently sent me this. This would be the SRF-16, a 16-inch M-Lock rail-equipped combat machine with all the internal updates that we see in other G&Gs, like the pre-installed electronic trigger unit and MOSFET system with an empty magazine power cutoff as long as you're using G&G's G2 magazines. You don't need to worry though, you can use any of your other standard M4 AEG magazines. Just don't expect the SRF to stop you from dry firing when your mags run dry. But there is an added twist here, a 6-position easy access stock connected to a folding buffer tube. It's super easy to use, there's no wires to pinch, and G&G is really proud of this new conductive hinge design. But if the SRF-16 is a little too large, then maybe consider the SRF-9. G&G is still exploring new options for their combat machine line, so there's something for every type of player. So if these SRFs suit you, then go ahead and hunt one down for yourself at your local retailers. But with that said, let's crack in to 8 airsoft loadouts. Starting with number 8, of course. Now, there were a lot of different types of loadouts turned in on the US Airsoft Facebook page where the submission poll was hosted, like this Ukrainian Foreign Legion inspired PMC kit by Naru, and stuff like this Simon Riley loadout by Steven of Prime PC Gaming. Then there was Jared of Wisconsin, donning his, quote, very low quality late period Roman kit with actual steel chainmail and helmet. While doing research into some history related projects, Jared decided that the often overlooked later period of the classical Roman Empire would make for an interesting kit, and he was definitely right. The loadout consists of a basic Coptic tunic reproduction, basic chainmail shirt, a reproduction of an intercisa type helmet, a foam larp spatha, hopefully I'm saying that right, basic leg wraps, gray work pants, a canvas belt acting as a baldric to carry the sword, black shoulder bag for ammo and water, miscellaneous Alice gear, and other webbing with a plush hedgehog backing him up. Surprisingly, this kit only ate up about $300 US, if you skip the A&K PKM, that is. In hindsight though, using a PKM may have been a mistake, as Jared would recommend not using this kit with an LMG unless you're not moving or if it's cold out, because the weight is pretty unbearable. I've seen some historical armor-cladded players before, but I appreciate Jared going another step above to complete this kit. Also, it'd give him bonus points for trying to use a PKM with it. It may not stand out to actual reenactment kits, and he might still go down with a single BB hit, but not many players on the field will have as much character as this. So that's why I would like to thank Jared for his submission. Going in a totally different direction for the 7th spot, I'm just amazed that someone took a harmless joke and ran with it like this. Introducing Nathan's Steve impression from Blue's Clues. Yeah, I said that. This loadout hits 2 great points. It can get a few great laughs, especially since Nathan does kind of look like Steve Burns, and it can suit just about any MilSim junkie. Originally from Michigan, Nathan's loadout has been a work in progress since he was in the United States Marine Corps. Most recently, he was assigned to a local SWAT team, and after leaving, he decided to put something new together in multicam that was similar to what he used when he was a part of the SWAT team. Now, it's more used for range work, instructing classes, and games. Altogether, this kit consists of a few thousand dollars worth of parts, which suits several roles. It's all quality gear from reputable manufacturers, so it did not come cheap. By the way, for this episode, I'll be including parts lists in the description for each of the spot holders because some of them have really long parts lists. Moving on though, like I just said, Nathan hooked this kit up with a lot of top quality pieces. I like that Shaw Concepts Arc 1 plate carrier he's got on, which isn't completely covered in patches and needless stuff stacked onto each other like some other loadouts I've seen. The TYR Tactical Ballistic Shoulder Pads are interesting, but definitely a nice touch. And I love the Steve patch. I really gotta get one of those for myself. Out of curiosity though, if you're a gear nerd, how do you feel about Nathan's parts list? Feel free to voice your opinions about his kit and all the others you see in this show anytime in the comments down below. These enthusiasts definitely deserve some love. But I just wanna say this now, I really love that you took this meme and made a loadout out of it. Absolutely top quality stuff. For the next three loadouts, we'll take a dive into the more realistic side of things, starting off with what I think is the first submission from Mexico that I've ever had. This is Saul of the Sierra Projects Group Airsoft Team and his Modern Warfare 2 Mexican Special Forces impression. This kit was said to be a perfect fit for Saul, as he can represent his country, replicate a loadout that he's seen in one of his favorite games right now, and because it's simple enough to work in and cosplay with at conventions. As for what it consists of, the plate carrier is a MaxTax QR4. In the front, we have a triple cry precision M4 mag pouch and a Blackbeard flag just because it's cool. On the sides, Saul only has side plate pouches from an unknown company. And finally, on the back, he has an LBX Velcro adapter to use the LBX banger panel in multicam, which is mainly used to hold water bladder and four Enola Gay smoke grenades. The helmet is an M-Flux replica helmet from an unknown company with PVS-14 replica NVGs on top. He then threw on a few Mexican flag pouches on the top and got a V-Light and Walker Razor ear protection. Now, after all this, he was still able to keep his budget really low thanks to swap meets and just trading pouches and other stuff between friends. He can only remember the plate carrier costing about $140. As for the replicas he uses, well, it's mainly H&K 416 replicas, despite it not being correct for the impression. It's just what he prefers to run. As for the secondary, Saul has a Glock 19 painted and stippled on a Milfront holster, which is Colombian made. Safariland holsters are hard to find, and this is the more correct one for the build. And that would be how you can copy both what you see in a video game and what you see in real life. Needless to say, we don't see very many South American submissions, due to a lot of the laws that limit enthusiasts in a lot of those countries, but I'm happy that I was able to take a look at this one. And I really hope that maybe we'll see some more in the future. But Saul, thank you for your submission. I very much appreciated it. Moving on though, we have to travel to the other side of the world again, to Belgium this time, for our next spot holder named Tobias of the 1st Battalion Boys, who is donning probably the most classy loadout in this countdown, capitalizing on the resurgence of the well-aged masterpiece that is Battlefield 1 at the 5th spot. I love when people replicate the obscure and unique, and World War 1 stuff is still pretty untouched by a lot of the airsoft industry, so of course Tobias was going to make the show for a kit that was put together because of the love of Battlefield 1, and since his ancestors served at Ypres. Consisting of a replica German M15 greatcoat and tunic with some wool pants and wool gaiters, a battle belt with an original bayonet and shovel, and a front metal chest piece, an original helmet with replica face shield and a gas mask, this kit is pretty spot on, and it should be for the 2,000 euros that was spent on it. That would be about $2,100 US dollars. I also love that he has a replica MP18 with a 3D printed drum mag and a Gewehr 98 from Trench Airsoft. Again, World War I replica stuff isn't done much in Airsoft, so it goes to show that Tobias went a bunch of extra kilometers to get this loadout finished. It's not the most complex thing on this list, but it doesn't have to be. It's still really unique. The stories connected to this passion piece are another great touch as well. And the photos? Absolutely stunning. Then, if we fast forward about 100 years, we'd find ourselves at number 4. Stefan has what I think to be the nicest modern loadout for the show. And it's here because law enforcement loadouts are not very common. But let's go ahead and get right into the parts list. Most of this kit is legit Cry Precision, including a JPC 2.0 with a back panel, replica airframes, Cry MRB, and Cry G3 uniform. And since everything here is real, Stefan has spent thousands of dollars on it. But that's a cost that's been spread over several years. His replica of choice has also been modded out to match the rest of his FBI kit. Everything is Magpul and VFC parts, and internally everything is completely custom. Not a single part is original. But his secondary is an Umarex G17 with an X300 light because it's simple and it gets the job done. Stefan here has a really cool kit, and if he wants to include something like a ballistic shield, well, he'll just make it himself. And he'll even have it weighed to be exactly as heavy as the real thing. So, for all the Riot Shield haters out here, does this make you angry or not anymore? Because now it really has its advantages and heavy disadvantages. I said a little bit earlier that law enforcement loadouts are pretty uncommon, but I just want to say this kit is really nice. It doesn't look too busy, and everything is supposed to be here. It doesn't look too heavy either, or bulky and wide, even if he runs real plates. It's just an overall clean setup. Maybe that's why I think it's the nicest of all the modern loadouts on this show. So when I started picking loadouts for this show, I didn't intend to rank them between the best loadouts and the worst or anything like that. This countdown is in no particular order. I wanted to make a more relaxed episode and see how people liked it. I'll do more of these if this video gets 2,000 likes. But be sure to tell me if I should show off more loadouts or just focus on particular replicas. I'm down for either, but just let me know in the comments. And if you would like to submit one day, then follow US Airsoft on Facebook or Instagram, so you'll see when I'm accepting entries. But we have 3 more kits, and all of them are really creative. We continue along with a Texas native, also named Nathan. A kendo and kenjutsu practitioner who wanted to try and carry over some unique aspects into other hobbies, which resulted in Nathan crafting a set of tactical samurai-esque armor. His reasons extend further than just being a skilled swordsman. You see, Nathan is extremely nearsighted, so he started running extended melee weapons to actually get hits when things get close up. Furthermore, his loadout is mainly centered around blade accessibility. Nathan tends to carry anywhere from 2 to 3 swords at a time, usually a katana and a wakizashi of some kind. They're secured using cord and paddle holsters. The main part of it is a shellback banshee with a viper hood and Tasmanian tiger battle belt. His plate armor is mounted to the viper hood and an inner belt respectively to achieve the iconic samurai look. The clothing underneath consists of a Rothko Midnight Digital Black combat uniform, but he's recently swapped to an Indo Gear multicam black combat outfit. Other than that, it's just some Amazon tactical gear like mag pouches and dumb pouches to complete the look that he wanted. And for the loadout costs, you're looking at about $400 for all of this. To add some extra style points, as if Nathan really needs them, he also uses a UMP-45 all the time. He's a big enthusiast for this replica. So he's got the Umarex electronic blowback version that he converted to HPA, and he has the VFC UMP-45 gas blowback Gen 3 that he just recently picked up. Then, for his sidearm, Nathan exclusively runs a Tokyo Marine Limited Edition Strike 45 with custom wooden grips, inspired by a certain anime. Now, I of course love this loadout for all the different reasons he has. It's of course also unique and even intimidating. It gave Nathan a great way to express himself and integrate several of his hobbies together, and he's the type of person who plays just to have fun. He is in his element, and the dedication to a single platform that's not an AK or an M4 is great. So that's why he has my respect. Now for the last two loadouts, I'm either going to see a lot of love in the comments going around, or a lot of people are going to be upset because I'm not including more serious loadouts. But don't worry, I plan to make another episode of this series. However, if you enjoy a good apocalyptic loadout, then you're in luck. At the runner-up spot, we have Davey from the Netherlands, who freaking nails home what these loadouts should look like with some Metro 2033 inspiration. And he definitely wins the Best Photos Award for this episode. Oddly enough, this loadout began because Davey got an LCT GO3 NV, since it had the vented heat shield that he saw in Metro Last Light. He had no idea if it was any good or not, but he never regretted his purchase. From there, Davey figured he should build an entire loadout surrounding it, and since he's been cosplaying for a while, everything just came together. For the helmet, you see, it was all custom made by someone on Etsy. Then came the vest that consists of the cheapest plate carrier Davey could find when he was starting out with Airsoft. He added on some old Alice webbing gear, some leather belts, a proper battle belt, and aluminum plates which are all held together with nuts and bolts, which does complete the homebrew look. He got himself a Bars Gurkha 3 suit, which he weathered by sanding it down and hitting it with a hammer, and even spray painting it, before patches inspired by the Metro Exodus concept art were added on. Davey also added on an SSO Smirsch webbing rig that he sanded down and threw all over the place to make it look older and used. Then, some replica Russian knee protection was added, as well as a plastic shin guard, so he could add on a rubber AK bayonet to finish it all off. With the LCT AKs that Davey has, and that one-of-a-kind helmet, he really made this loadout look like a masterpiece, while still looking really janky. But that's the effect that he was going for, right? So I guess you can say it is a masterpiece. He has more video game inspired kits coming along, including a Team Fortress 2 Pyro loadout in the works, so we just might see Davey in another show in the future. If it's even half the quality of this loadout, then I'm sure it'll be high up on the countdown. I would say that you're doing a wonderful job at representing your country for the countdown, Davey. Really, really cool kit. I love this. But we have to round off this countdown. After 7 awesome loadouts, we've come down to number 1. Again, I didn't sort this countdown by any particular order. You let me know in the comments down below which one you like the most. Was it one of the more realistic tactical loadouts, or was it one of the more quirky ones? Or is it Nick's Doomslayer? As the manager of Gladiator Paintball Park, he had to be the most standout player at his own field, and this is definitely the way to go. The reason why I made this suit was to do a Halloween Juggernaut game mode, but there was a lot of demand for more Juggernaut game types throughout the year. Also, I'm a huge fan of the Doom games, said Nick. This was made mostly of foam and an old rental paintball vest, which he used as a base with Velcro added to connect the foam pieces. He also headed off to Etsy to acquire the helmet that is more than capable of taking hits. Of course, he also has a Bluetooth speaker with him at all times to play the Doom OST or some other heavy metal. You know, to alert players that the Slayer is nearby. If they decide to stick around, then they'll have to deal with a classic army micro gun. Nick used to run a double barrel shotgun, but sadly, it broke a while ago. But I would say that someone needs to make this guy a BFG. The suit is always undergoing some changes, but hopefully a version 2 will begin construction soon to continue the Juggernaut games. And for $400 US? I couldn't see why he wouldn't make more of these loadouts. It is about time that I've seen a really good Doom loadout, and I might still want to see some killzone loadouts, but one step at a time is fine by me. If you've been doing this kind of stuff for a while, then you've seen a lot of juggernaut loadouts and kits and builds and all sorts of stuff like that, and sometimes they do blend into one another, but this one is special. I love the inspiration, I love that it has a theme, and that's what makes it really cool and one of a kind as well. And I will always accept more video game themed loadouts. Overall, the more unique stuff in our game, the better. But with that said, I hope you enjoyed all these loadouts. And I hope that you got some inspiration from this countdown. Of course, I want to thank SS Airsoft again, along with GNG Armament, for making this video come together. I'm really happy that I finally got to come back to the community countdowns and make some more episodes of the Airsoft Tops series. I have a whole lot of ideas that I want to expand on and open up polls for, just so I can see a lot of the cool stuff that you guys have been building for months and years and so on. I love the creativity in the community. Please never stop just being yourselves. And with that, I would like to thank you all for watching. And I would like to thank all the people who submitted a loadout for this show. Remember, take a look at the US Airsoft Facebook and Instagram page so you can make a submission whenever the submission polls open up in the future. But until that next video drops from the city of Dallas, Texas, this has been Scott Hollenbeck, and I will be sure to see you all next time.